Welcome back, everyone. My name is Darmadi Komo, and I'm SQL Server Product Manager in Redmond. Today, we're going to have Evgeny here with us from engineering. He's going to show us great new features in SQL Server 2014. Evgeny, would you want to tell us about yourself and where are you going to talk about?
I'm Evgeny Kirvashev, and I'm Program Manager in SQL Server. I'm working on a set of features which are related to SQL Server performance and SQL Server hybrid experiences. So I had some industry experience before, so and that's wide variety of things in industry. So today we're going to speak about a couple of features we have on a SQL Server. So the two features I would like to discuss today is buffer pool extension. And another feature is an extension of resource governor to support the I/O. Input-output is an important thing for the resources that exist on a computer, so we're also going to spend some time on that. So the first thing in the list is an extension of the buffer pool. That's a feature that's basically takes your existing buffer pool and tries to make sure that you have enough space in it, even if you have some hardware constraints. So in this model, I will talk a little bit about the three things. First, I would like to give you some overview of how memory management works for SQL Server, so you understand what exactly we did in this feature. Then I would talk a little bit about what exactly we changed, why that feature was built, what it does, and the third topic will be how you can actually control that feature and what kind of knobs, what kind of performance counters you can have in it.
Great. Can you refresh our memory on how buffer pool works in SQL Server?
Yes, sure. So there is a component that called buffer pool manager. And that component manages most important resource of SQL Server. That's a most important resource called pages. Those pages store all the data. Those pages store some of the additional information that exists. And that buffer manager actually is a central component that accumulates pages coming from different directions. And it grows a pool of pages when it's needed. It shrinks that pool of pages when there is memory pressure that requires SQL Server to release some memory to some other components. And because this is the most important thing, this is the thing that touches all the other components. But nobody else except buffer pool manager can actually touch the buffer pool of the SQL Server. So only the buffer pool manager knows what's going on. And even if, for example, transaction log would like to store some pages in a buffer pool, it goes to the buffer manager, and buffer pool manager actually does that work for the transaction log methods.
Okay, so can you tell us the scenarios, what you have in mind when you're actually designing changes in SQL 2014?
Yeah, we have few things in mind when we have been actually thinking about that feature. One of the key thing is how to increase the server's memory because it's the most important, the easiest way to improve performance of SQL Server related to OLTP. All your OLTP queries actually use a lot of buffer pool, and increasing size of the buffer pool impacts that performance directly. Another thing that while increasing memory is always a good thing, at the same time, it's sometimes maybe hard thing to implement because machines has limited amount of memory supported. Sometimes even if you have possibility to increase amount of memory, there may be other complications like you don't want to turn machine down in order to do that maintenance work in adding memory. In some cases, you need to do some expensive upgrades before you can increase memory. So all those things limit your real possibilities of improving that memory and I/O balance. At the same time, it's usually way more easier to add the new storage devices to the same machines that can be really constrained with regards to memory. That's why we decided that probably we should try the route of using the storage devices rather than memory. So based on those starting points, we went ahead with changes to buffer pool manager that now it introduces a thing which called buffer pool extension. Buffer pool extension is basically your non-volatile extension to your dynamic memory. What it does, it's creates some mapping between the memory you have and the storage device you have. And because this mapping exists, it allows you to map more memory than you have actually. That works similarly to how Windows page file works, for example. But because SQL Server knows better what kind of content we manage, we usually do that more effectively than when you only rely on the operating system page file. And as I mentioned already, the buffer pool is actually the most used part of the SQL Server memory management. That's the hugest memory block in a SQL Server, maybe the only in-memory technologies can compete with it. And this is the most critical part of memory pool to reduce the I/O pressure, because the more memory you have, the less actual I/Os you will be doing.
So can you let us know in more detail how this buffer pool extension works?
As I mentioned before, we implemented buffer pool extension as a kind of page file for an existing buffer pool memory. What it does, we, in a SQL Server, we have a notion of clean and dirty pages. It's really easy separation between those two, because clean page is a page that doesn't need to be stored on a disk because it doesn't have any pending writes. So it hasn't been changed since we read it. Dirty page is a page that was changed since we read it, or it was just created, so it hasn't been written to the disk yet. When we see the clean page, we can decide what to do with it. And when this clean page came to the eviction threshold, and eviction threshold is a situation when you have a memory pressure and your memory is already filled with your pages, and you need to put new pages in that memory. When that situation happens, this means that you need to get rid of some old pages. And this is eviction point. So when we go to situation when we need to evict the clean page, instead of just evicting it like we do in a normal buffer management situation, we can put it on the storage device. And usually we expect this would be SSD device. So but when you create your extension, we don't really expect you to put this on a normal rotating media. It's because you will not get any benefits from that. So instead of evicting page in one stage, we evict it first to the SSD, and we can read it back really quickly if we need it. And only when our extension file became full, we can evict it completely. Another situation is when page is dirty. And when page is dirty, we need to write it to the database file first or to the log file first. And we're doing that operation when we need to evict the dirty page. But at the same time, if we think we have a chance to keep this page on the SSD device, on the, in the extension file, we will try to do the write to the same places at the same time. So when the longest write to the database file is completed, because most likely your database file is on a slower device, at the same time we would already have that page in an extension file. And we call that operation dual write, that kind of optimization that help us to move things faster. And this is explanation of how we manage different kind of pages, how we decide what to evict and what not to evict. So we have a notion of page hotness, page temperature. So we call pages hot if there is a reason to keep them in memory. Those pages usually accessed recently and changed recently, so for whatever reason, those are really needed to SQL Server database engine. On the next stage, we see that pages kind of cools down, and we think it's probably not worth to keep them in a dynamic memory, but instead we can keep them on some caching device which we use to store extension file. And finally, when we see enough memory pressure to evict pages from the extension file, we call those pages cold pages, and we either evict them to the database, or also all pages that haven't been read from the database files yet, also called the cold pages.
I see. So now we understand how the buffer pool extension works. How easy it is to configure? Is it like one-liner, or do we have to restart the server and things like that? Can you show us how to do it?
Yeah, so the configuration DDL is pretty simple, and that's make it easy to configure it. All that you need to specify when you configure a buffer pool extension feature is where to store it, just the fact that you would like to enable that feature, and the size of the feature. When you don't need that feature, or when you would like to change any configuration parameter related to it, you need to turn it off first. And just kind of warning that you need to have a permission to alter server state, because you're using alter server configuration command to modify that. And I can show the short demo for that command, just to show how it actually works. So first thing I would like to show, I just would like to show the folders that I created on the machine, and you see it's currently empty, so I can even refresh it. And now we're going to run very simple command that should configure your buffer pool extension. You see, all that I'm doing is issuing the alter server configuration command, and I'm saying I would like to turn buffer pool extension on and place it in the folders that I have created already and set size to 10 gigabyte. After that, I would like to change that configuration. And if I would just try to reissue that command, I would get an error because it's already configured. So the only option I have is to use the same alter server configuration and turn the feature off. Okay. And you see that that command works correctly. When I turn it off, I can do some other configuration changes. And why it's important to turn it off first, because when you have your SQL Server instance rely on a buffer pool extension and you need to change any configuration, at the moment we change in configuration, you will see the performance impact. So we would like that to be explicit for you. That's why we're asking you to turn it off explicitly, so you would be aware of that performance impact that you would see. And now I would like to show you some interesting moment related to the buffer pool extension. You remember that first we configured it with a size of 10 gigabytes, and now we're going to configure it with a size of 5 of them. And that comment fails. Why that fails? Because once we put memory reservation inside buffer pool manager for the extension file, we only release that memory reservation when we restart the SQL server. So you can only have the same or bigger size of the buffer pool extension. And obviously your starting point is your actual memory size. So how much max server memory you have configured for your SQL server, either that the all machine memory or half of that machine memory would be your initial buffer pool extension configuration. And now when we have the feature configured, I just would like to show you that when it's configured, the only thing you see is a file in a folder which you choosing to store that. And this is just a normal file operation, so you can actually use any file storage device to store it. And just to quickly recap how it looks, as I told already, first you configure your buffer pool extension, you specify size and location. Then if you would like to change the config, you need to first turn it off, then update your configuration parameters, and then turn it on back.
How about some best practices? Can you share with us the best practices on how to configure this?
Yes. So there are few things that you need to keep in mind when you're talking about buffer pool extension. So there is a new DMV that allows you to check its current configuration in case you need to check how your instance is configured currently. Also, there are a few limitations that I touched already. First, that the minimum buffer pool extension size is same or bigger than your max server memory of the instance which you are configuring. Another thing that when you reconfigure the buffer pool extension, it cannot go smaller than it was before. And if for whatever reason you think you need to have that memory back, you need to restart your SQL Server instance. That's the only way how you can get this memory back. However, there I would like to mention one thing. So we are only reserving the memory. We are not committing that memory until SQL Server starts actually using it. So if you worried about situation, I have just turned my buffer pool extension on with enormous amount of memory, and this means that I lost all the memory. No, you haven't actually lost even a single byte. We just put some memory reservations, but those reservations actually haven't been claimed yet.
I see. So how about troubleshooting? How do I monitor what's going on with buffer pool extension?
So there are a few options that are available for you when you troubleshoot buffer pool extension. First, there are existing DMVs that we have updated, and this is DMV called CSDM OS Buffer Descriptors that allows you to see what's going on with your memory on a descriptor level. And with those descriptor levels, individual descriptors, you can see if this descriptor goes into the extension, if it's stored in a main memory, if it's being evicted. So we currently provide that information to you. Another thing we did, in case you really would like to watch how we move the pages between all those parts of buffer pool manager, is the next event. It tells you when we start to write pages to an extension. It tells you when we try to read pages from an extension. And it tells you about situation when we try to recalculate the eviction threshold. Another thing you can use, especially in case if you would like to see how buffer pool extension operates in the context of bigger situation, like the whole application running, is a performance counter. When you have your performance counters, you can monitor a few performance counters from your application, few of them from the SQL server, and some of those performance counters can be related to the buffer pool extension. And there is a plenty of performance counters you can use. So it's page reads, writes per second, it's evictions, it shows you when we allocate and deallocate pages, it shows you when what is the lifetime of pages expected, and what is the outstanding I/O counter, which actually may be one of the most important performance counters, because it would allow you to see if your caching device is actually capable of handling the flow of pages we're trying to put on it.
One quick question on buffer pool extension. A lot of our customers are running mission critical database applications, and they're running in clustering environment, right? So how does this buffer pool extension affect in the clustering environment?
That's a really good question. Thank you for that. We actually, I mentioned that already a little bit, but I really would like to focus on that at this point, because buffer pool extension is only stores the clean pages. This means that pages which are in a buffer pool extension file doesn't expect to be written to the disk at any point of time. So you can lose those pages and don't see any data loss as a result of this. So if you have your buffer pool extension in your clustering environment, and if there is a failover happens, you are not losing anything which is part of the extension file. If you have some disparity in buffer pool extension sizes between different cluster instances, yes, you can potentially see some performance differences. But the same situation may happen when you have just the memory differences or storage operates at a different speed. So let me just quickly recap what are the most important points with regards to the buffer pool extension. First, buffer pool extension allows you to use cheaper SSD devices to reduce the memory pressure that SQL Server experiences. As I have just mentioned, there is no risk of data loss associated with buffer pool extension. All pages that we store in the buffer pool extension are already in your data or log files. So you don't need to worry about anything special with regards to it. We have seen very good performance improvements when we had been doing internal testing, but obviously that hugely depends on your specific workload. So we always encourage you to test on your workload rather than just really on numbers that we can tell you about the performance. That's probably true about any performance situation. That feature is only available on SQL Server Enterprise Edition. And if you don't want where to start, we think that the best return for your investment you probably will get in around 4 to 10 times of your memory size that you dedicate to your SQL Server. And one important thing to mention that this improvement mostly targets OLTP workloads. So if you thinking about optimizing your data warehouse workloads, probably that feature will not be really helpful for you. So don't rely on it. So the next thing I would like to talk about would be the resource governor and changes we did in the resource governor for input-output support. I would like to do things similarly to what we had for the buffer pool extension. And first, I would like to do some recap of how resource governor works. Then I would like to talk a little bit of what specific changes and why we did for SQL Server 2014. And finally, we talk about how you can control the resource governor feature.
Okay. Now is a good time to refresh our memory on resource governor that shipped with SQL Server before.
Yeah, thank you. The resource governor works in the following way. So it accumulates requests for different resources that coming from different queries, applications. Then it attributes those requests in a way that basically you control when you set up the resource governor. You can write your own functions that would be bucketizing those requests in different buckets. Then when you when this bucketization is done, those are assigned to different groups or pools. And those pools actually can be controlled differently based on the parameters that you assign to them. And if something wasn't assigned to any specific group or pool, it will be assigned to the default group because they need to be assigned somewhere. And default group will use the remaining remaining resources of the SQL Server instance. And also there is a thing to mention that there is an internal pool available in a SQL Server that you can't actually control. And SQL Server tries to maintain that pool in a way that you always can connect to the SQL Server with your administrator connections. And SQL Server always has some resources to run background tasks and similar things. And finally, I just would like to mention that the maximum number of pools is 64. So just try to think in that number when you're planning your resources.
Okay. Can you tell us the scenario, what do you have in mind when you're designing these changes in Resource Governor in 2014?
Yeah, so mostly this feature was driven by the customer's feedback who had been already using Resource Governor for different situations. And what we have heard from customers that while we're providing a lot of isolation for CPU, for memory, they still see a lot of problems on the level of I/O. And probably that was the most important part of the resource governor because it's easy to saturate the I/O channel rather than most of other channels, probably except for the memory channel. So, and the second thing that what we have heard from multiple customers that predictability is usually preferred over the individual performance, and lack of predictability is hitting them harder than any individual lack of the reached performance goals. So this is why we went with this feature forward.
Okay, give us an example of what are the changes that you put in the configuration and the resource governor in SQL 2014?
So what we did for resource governor, we added two parameters per pool configuration, and those two parameters can be used to specify the minimum amount of IOPS per volume, and IOPS is actually IO per second, and the maximum amount. So probably for minimum amount, it's not as important to specify. It's good to know what would be the minimum number of IOs available for your application, but at the same time, it's usually more important to know what would be the maximum amount available for your application when it's needed. And the second thing we did is we did limitation per volume. That allows you to constrain how your SQL Server stresses your individual rotational devices. And this is also important thing to keep in mind because oversaturated I/O can create the whole set of problems for applications.
Okay, that's very cool. How do we monitor or troubleshoot resource governor for I/O then?
We did a lot of changes for monitoring resource governor, and since resource governor can touch a lot of applications and all those applications can have different requirements, we did a lot of DMV changes for an existing DMVs. So first DMV that we have changed is resource governor resource pools. And what we added is a new columns for maximum I/O, for actual read-write queries for any stale situations and for any I/O violations. And I/O violation is situation when your produced I/O is less than committed I/O. That's probably would be the most interesting parameter for you when you would be monitoring resource governor pools. Another situation is when you would like to monitor resource governor at all, and in that case you only would like to have limited number of parameters like I/O read-write stale latency. And we also introduced the new DMV that's called resource governor resource pool volumes, and this is the per pool per pool DMV that shows you all the read-write queries, completed queries, same as resource pools. It shows you violations and also it shows you completed queries. Also, same as buffer pool extension, we added X events and the performance counters, and those X events allows you to monitor writes and reads, and if you would use them together with events that trace I/O issuing situations like file read writes and I/O completion, you would see the complete chain of operations and how buffer pool actually affects that. Also, we added six new performance counters. I'm not listing them individually because it's just a list of performance counters, but basically they allow you to track read and writes of IOs and the throughput in bytes, and they allow you to write to track read and write latency of operations.
This is awesome. So one final question for you is, resource governor for IO, can this be used for other SQL Server 2014 technologies like in-memory OLTP, for example?
You can definitely limit the amount of data that coming to the volumes through your database files, but in-memory OLTP is currently not covered by the resource governor.
Okay. Well, thank you so much, Kenny. Thank you for giving out this session. I'm hoping that everyone here benefit from the session already. And thank you on behalf of SQL Server team. Thank you for attending the entire day's event on Mission Critical Performance on SQL Server 2014. But there's more. I want to remind you two things. First of all, tomorrow we'll have another session, full day session on SQL Server 2014 on the hybrid cloud capabilities. So that's happening tomorrow. Make sure that you tune in that as well. The other one is on the bottom of your screen. You should have this poll that we put in there. Make sure that you can submit your feedback and score of these sessions today throughout the day. And make sure that we get that. We appreciate your time today again. Thank you for attending this session.